For us, I want to do something with you today as a declaration about the Word of God. We just sang about that in the four verses of that song. So I would invite you to take a hold of your own Bible if you brought it from home, or take a hold of the Bible that's in the pew rack in front of you there. And we're going to make some declarations. I'm going to invite you to respond after me. You can hold your Bible up like the good old sword fight days, or you can just hold it in your hand. This is my Bible. It is the Word of God. It is the sword of the Spirit. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I believe what it tells me to believe. I do what it tells me to do. Devil, I'm armed. And you should consider me dangerous. Amen. All right, we're going to go to James chapter 2 today. Steve, come on up and just share that scripture for us. Appreciate you helping me out with a little bit of voice retention this morning.
So today's scripture is from the book of James chapter 2, verse 14 through 26. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, "Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed," but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, "You have faith, I have deeds." Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish man, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not our ancestor Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, "Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend." You see that a person is justified by what he does, and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let's bow in prayer, please. O Lord, your word is a lamp unto our feet. It is a light unto our path. Father, give us open ears and minds just now, that we might receive and understand your truth. Give us humble and teachable hearts, that we may be obedient to your will and live always for your glory. By your Holy Spirit's power, illumine us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this passage is building on what James started saying in chapter 1. Back in verse 22, if you have your Bible open, you can look back at that, but I'll put it up on the screen so we can look back at that a moment and see what he says there. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. And let me just stop there and remind us this morning that just as James said in verse 18 of chapter 1, God gave us spiritual birth through the word of truth. And three verses later, in verse 21, you'll see that James tells us there, humbly accept the word that is planted in you, which can save you. The word can save you. Wow. That might sound startling, but it really is no different than what the Apostle Paul said in Romans 1:16. Remember, he says the word, the gospel, is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes. Or in Ephesians 1:13, where Paul says, You were included in Christ when? When you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Or I like this one in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 and 2. Paul declares, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, listen, by this gospel you are saved. If you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. In other words, Paul is saying, if you don't hold firmly to the word of God, your belief is in vain. If you don't cling to the word and live out the word, you might not be saved. Wow. So Martin Luther was wrong. Luther was the one who said, we don't need the book of James, throw it out of the Bible. Luther was wrong. The Apostle Paul did not disagree with James. They really teach the same thing. And of course they do. God doesn't contradict himself in his word. Never. It might seem like it to us, but never. James and Paul both consistently teach that true believers are people who submit to the Christ of the Bible as their Savior and Lord, and who live under the Word of God. They submit to the without reservation to the Bible's authority. They hold firmly to its teachings, its promises. They heed its warnings, and they follow its commandments. So we are a people who are to be captive to God's Word. To use the Bible to test all human ideas and to accept nothing that is contrary to the Word of God. So, question of application. Do you do that? Do you use the Bible to test all human ideas? And there's all kinds of ideas out there, isn't there? And do you use the Bible to, or do you accept that nothing is contrary to the Word of God? If you don't do that, and you begin experiencing problems in your life, it is very possible that those problems are stemming directly from the fact that you are not living fully according to the Word of God. Now, I can think of so many Christians that I've known throughout the years who, you know, carry around a Bible. You know, they may have it on their smartphone. They have one in the glove box of their car. They have one on the rack next to the throne room, you know. But they don't take living the Bible seriously. In their day-to-day experience, they kind of neglect or they disregard, maybe without even realizing it, they disregard what the Bible says. And then they get into all kinds of trouble. And they get into this trouble, they get into these messes, and they come to us pastors, and we'll ask them, well, are you reading? And they say, what, the newspaper? No, the Bible. Are you reading the Bible? How much time? And they say, well, yeah, and I can tell. They're really not reading the Bible. And they say, yeah, you know, 5 minutes in the morning. And I want to say, try reading for an hour a day for the next month. And let's see if the situation changes. What does the Word of God say about your situation and how you should be living? And how will you know if you don't spend any time in it? And how will it change you if you don't believe it or live according to it? Friends, it is utterly remarkable the power that is in the Word of God. It has the power, Paul said, to bring us to salvation. Now, if it has that power, what else is it able to accomplish in our lives? Can you think of anything it couldn't do? I can stand up here and preach my heart out or my voice out on Sundays. But you need to be in the Word of God yourself. We need to be like the Bereans in Acts 17. Remember those folks? Paul says of them, or Luke says of them in verse 11, the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness, and they examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. And it's interesting, I'm named after the Apostle Paul. If I stand up here and I say something that disagrees with the word, brothers and sisters, you need to do what the Word says as the Holy Spirit reveals that to you. But you've got to study the Word to know what it says. And the Word of God, friends, will change you if you give it a chance. Remember that Jesus prayed for us in his high priestly prayer in John 17, Father, sanctify them, meaning us, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. So the word of God not only has the power to save you, it has the power to sanctify you, to make you holy. And God says, be ye holy, even as I am holy. But you've got to give it a chance. Now, all of that is kind of introductory, but it's crucial for this section of teaching from James, because James is calling us to be doers of the word, not doers of the pastor's opinions, not doers of your own personal theology and how you choose to interpret scripture, not doers of denominational policy, doers of the word. Those who live out the word and put their faith into action through the word. It's like taking a weapon into battle. Or let's use a more familiar illustration today, because it's bow hunting season and opening day for rifle is just a couple of 12 days away, to be exact. Like taking a weapon into the woods to go hunting. Now, Paul tells us in Ephesians 6 that the word is our sole offensive weapon. And I think we all know that if we go out into spiritual battle against the devil and against the principalities of this present darkness, of this world system, we're toast. We're toast. If you went hunting for a deer or a moose or anything else without a weapon, would you expect to get anything? Of course not. Not unless you expect the deer to come wandering down the trail, find your blind, lay down in your blind, and wait for you to clunk them on the head. It doesn't work that way. You have to be armed. And you have to know how to use your weapon. And then you have to actually use it. But we're talking about the Bible. We're not talking about deer hunting. We'll talk about that later. We're talking about the Bible. How do you respond to trials and temptations? How do you overcome doubts and fears? How do you show that you humbly accept the word that is planted in you and able to save your soul? You do the word, James says. You do the word. It was kind of interesting in my study for this. We are only given in Scripture a record of 3 times that the voice of Satan is actually shared with us. The first time is in the Garden of Eden, obviously, with Adam and Eve, where Satan accuses God before them, before man. The second time is in the first chapter of Job, where Satan appears and accuses man to God. Just the opposite. The third time is in the Gospels, in the wilderness temptations of Jesus, when Satan confronts the true God-man. And he's got more than his hands full. Because every time Satan tries to get Jesus to do the wrong thing, what does Jesus do? He says, it is written, it is written, it is written. And we only have three of those occasions, but there were probably more. And Jesus, I think, every time said, "It is written, it is written." Folks, nothing will keep you safer when trials and temptations come than knowing and doing the Word of God. It's what Jesus did. And that's why we are trying so hard to, in our Awana program and in our Sunday school and in other venues of our ministry, to teach people to memorize the Word of God. We want to arm these kids and all of us for battle, because we're in a battle. James talks in chapter 1 here about someone who just listens to the Word but doesn't do what he says, what it says. And he compares them to someone who looks at themselves in a mirror. Have you ever noticed that mirrors don't lie? They show you exactly what you look like. Blemishes, zits, wrinkles, the whole nine yards. If you want a perfectly honest assessment of what you look like, just look in the mirror. And you know what James is saying? The Bible will give you an honest assessment of your life. You want to see what your soul and your spiritual life really looks like? Open the Word. The Word of God is living and active, the Scripture says. Now, if you're a believer and you have not experienced that the Word of God is living and active, something's wrong. Something's wrong. Because I don't know about you, but when I'm reading the Bible, it jumps off the page and slaps me in the face. It's living. The Word brings conviction. It leads us to repentance. And it empowers us to do the things that God commands us to do. Because we can't do them in our own strength. If you're a true child of God, you know when you're reading the Word that it's God Himself speaking to you in this book. Mirrors do not lie, and God does not lie. His Word is trustworthy. God will always be honest with you about what you need to do and what you need to be, because His desire is to make you complete, to be mature, to bring you to the perfection of the character of Christ. That's what He wants to do through His Word. And so verse 25, still back in chapter 1, we'll get to chapter 2, I promise. The man, look at this verse, the man who looks intently, or implied woman, into the perfect law that gives freedom. Now that's talking about the Scriptures. And, notice, continues, underline the word continues in your Bible if you do that, continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, or in parentheses, or read, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Now, we're spending all of this time getting into the last half of chapter 2 because James is laying out a prescription for living a life of faith that is full of good deeds. Full of good works. And he's saying the power for that is the living God. It is the Holy Spirit of God, and that power will be accessed by you as you get into the pure and living Word of God, inspired by the Spirit of God. That's how it works. Okay, let's go to chapter 2. Let me say a word about this whole idea that Paul and James disagree with each other in their theology. As we look at verses 14 to 26, which Steve read for us, thank you, Steve, we have to remember that when the Apostle Paul talks about the doctrine of justification, how a person is saved, he talks about the works of the law and the problem of the law, the problem of the Judaizers. Remember our study in Galatians? The Judaizers, who are people who said that you could be saved by keeping the law. Obviously, if that were possible, that would diminish the role of faith in our salvation, right? More than that, it makes the atoning death of Jesus unnecessary. If you could save yourself by being a good person and keeping the commandments, why did God bother sending his son to die on a cross for you? Why would he do that? We remember, I trust, Paul's classic verse in Ephesians 2, verse 8, where he insists that it's by grace we are saved, through faith, and that not of ourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works. So no one can boast. And what James says, very simply, is if you claim that you're saved, if you claim that you're a Christian, then let me see the evidence. The Bible teaches very plainly that once the Word of God takes root in us, once the Spirit of God has come to live in us, there will be fruit. Fruit. Even Jesus himself said, by their fruit you will know them. By their fruits you'll know who are truly my disciples and those who are not. But the point is, once you are saved, there will be evidence that you're a believer. Now, the confusion on this whole Paul versus James thing, I think, comes from the fact that Paul and James are looking at salvation from two different perspectives. Paul is looking at the means by which we're saved in the first place, and James is looking at what our life should be and look like after we're saved. Or we could say Paul looks at justification pre-salvation and James looks at it post-salvation. Does that make sense? James' whole argument rests on the fact that once you are in Christ, and Paul says this in 2 Corinthians 5:17, you are a new creation. The old person is dead and gone, and you are a whole new person. And that new person is going to do the things that a spirit-filled man or woman does. Will you continue to sin? Sure. We will do that until the day we die, because we are sinners by nature. But it should be less and less and less as the Spirit of God sanctifies you and gets into your mind and into your will and into your emotions and into your decisions and into every part of you. It's less and less. The Bible says, let those who name the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Remember that wonderful story in John chapter 8 of the woman caught in adultery? And Jesus says to her, she's not condemned. He says, you've been forgiven. But then what does he say to her at the very end? Go and sin no more. Jesus' expectation is that forgiven people will not go on doing the same sinful things that they have always done. Their response to God in gratitude for their salvation is to obey God. So we have to be wary of anyone who calls him or herself a Christian and then wants to commit sin or is completely unwielding and unwilling to stop a particular sin. And it doesn't matter what the sin is. I mean, we might automatically think about situations like a young man who wants to invite his girlfriend to have premarital sex. Or we might think about, you know, teenagers who, you know, are invited to go to a party or do some drugs or whatever. But, you know, I mean, it doesn't have to be that kind of thing. It can be, you know, the temptation to gossip or to cheat on your taxes or to tell a little white lie or to look at porn on the internet. Sin is sin. And when you confront a fellow believer about something like that, and we should, and they say to you, hey, who are you to judge me? And we've heard that, haven't we? We should say, I'm not judging you. I'm just a fruit inspector. And the fruit of your Christian life right now is pretty rotten. I'm just showing you the evidence of what I'm seeing. Hey, I am not your judge. God is your judge. But I'm here to tell you that God has already rendered his judgment about what you're doing in his word. It's right there. I'm just telling you what he already said. James says, what good is it to say that you're a Christian if there's no evidence of that in your life? If there's no changed life, if there's no changed attitude towards sin? The proof is in the pudding. I think what James is going after here, really, is the disconnect between what a person professes, what they say, and what they actually do. So he's kind of getting at hypocrisy. He's getting at hypocrisy. He uses this illustration. If you say to someone who's hungry, I wish you well, keep warm, be well fed, but then you don't do anything to help them, it's hypocritical. You don't really wish them well. You just want them to think you wish them well. But for all practical purposes, your faith is useless because it hasn't done anything except try to make you look good, and that doesn't spring from faith. Friends, faith in Jesus Christ is not a confession, a profession. It's a life-changing experience. I think James is simply saying the same thing that we hear when someone comes to the church here and they get saved. And then they start bringing their friends. And their friends say, you know, we knew that there was something real, that there was something of God going on here because we saw the change in our friend's life. I mean, he doesn't want to go out drinking with us anymore. His whole attitude is different. His speech isn't the same. And we wanted to know, what was it that brought about that radical change in our friend's life? Well, in verse 19, James starts speaking to the Jews directly. Now remember, he's the pastor of the church in Jerusalem, so there's a lot of Jews around James. He speaks to them directly because he says, you believe in one God. Now, that's what the Jews said every single day in their daily prayer. You know the Shema of Israel? Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God, the Lord is one. That's the Shema prayer of Jews. And James says, that's okay. Good prayer. Nothing wrong with that. It's good to believe that because God is one. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in one essence. One God. But even the demons believe that. Even Satan and all of his demons believe. Now think about this. I had to try to wrap my mind around this week. Satan and all of his minions know the truth about God. They know for a fact who he is and what he has done. There are no atheist demons. In fact, intellectually, they are very orthodox believers, because they've been around a long time. They saw God create the universe, many of them. I don't know about all of them, but many of them. They saw God send his Son into this world. They saw him die on the cross at Calvary. And they shuddered and they screamed on Easter Sunday morning when they watched him rise from the dead. They believe. And James says that they shudder. They sit in fear and in abject horror. And we saw that in the Gospels. Every time Jesus encounters a demon, they shriek and they scream and they plead for mercy. Because they know exactly who God is. They know exactly who Jesus is and who the Holy Spirit is. But here's the question. Will they go to heaven? They believe? No, of course not. We know they won't because the Bible says they won't. They're destined for hell. That's where they belong. But here's the thing. There's a difference between believing with your head and believing with your heart. Believing with your head is nothing more than intellectual assent. But believing with your heart takes faith. It is faith. It's trust. It's trust. Let me tell you the true story of Blondin the Great. I know I've shared this with a few of you. I think I shared it with our home group. It's one of my favorite stories. Blondin was a high wire artist, famous tightrope walker back in the late 1800s. And he wanted to prove his greatness by walking over a tightrope stretched over the Niagara Falls. And so they set it up, and tens of thousands of people were there that day. I mean, you can imagine if something like that went on today. Oh man, big turnout. Tickets were probably 25 cents. Outrageous. So Blondin walks successfully over the tightrope for the first time. He gets to the other side and he screams to the crowd, "I am Blondin the Great! Do you believe?" And the crowd exclaims, "We believe!" And he says, "I am Blondin the Great. I will now cross the dangerous falls again, but this time with someone on my back. Do you believe?" And the crowd exclaims, "We believe! We believe!" And then he lowers the punchline, "And which of you will be that person?" No one moved a muscle. They didn't even want to scratch their heads for fear that they'd be looked at as a volunteer. Moments later, a man steps out and he says, "I will go. I will volunteer." Now, it turns out that that guy was actually Blondin's helper, obviously on a substantial payroll. But the point is that thousands of people stood there and said they believed in Blondin. But really, only one man believed, because he was the man who put his trust in Blondin the Great. James gives two examples here of people who really believed God, Abraham and Rahab, because they both trusted God to keep his promises, to do what he said he was going to do. And James ends chapter 2 on this note: "As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead." In other words, if all you do is believe in your head, intellectual assent, that God created the world, that God is real, that God sent Jesus into this world, and that God's in control of everything, same thing the demons believe, but you don't trust the Lord for your everyday life, and every single day of your life you commit to him and you look to him and you lean on him and you count on him and you live in a dynamic relationship with him every single day, it is possible, my friend, that you are spiritually dead. If it's all up here. And then the next question is, if you are spiritually dead, what is your destiny? Is it any different than the demons of hell? That's a sobering question. And that is why Jesus says to us today, as he said to Nicodemus, "You must be born again. You must be born again." There has to be a fundamental change in your heart, which only the Spirit of God can bring about. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh," not going to heaven, implied, "but that which is born of the Spirit is spirit," on its way to heaven. Big difference. And you may say, "Well, Pastor Paul, how does that happen? I've been going to church all of my life, and now that you're talking to me, I've got some doubts. How does it happen?" Friends, it happens by an act of absolute surrender, of consciously, of willfully giving your life over to the control of Jesus Christ. And I want to invite you to do that this morning. I want every single one of us to be absolutely certain that when our Georgie Barrett moment comes, Georgie was with us in church 3 Sundays ago, and she is no more. But when our Georgie Barrett moment comes, I want you to be absolutely certain, and I want everyone who knows you, and especially your family, to have the confidence and the peace and the wonderful joy of knowing, as we know with Georgie, where you've gone. Following Jesus is not a head thing. It is not a church thing. It is not a profession thing. It is a life thing. And Jesus says, give me your life. Lay it all down. Die to yourself. Give it up. You can't do this. Trust me. Come with me. Follow me. Die daily with me, and I will give you eternal life. That's the gospel. Hallelujah. Let's pray, please. Lord, I sat in church for many years before, by the graciousness of your Spirit and by your love, you revealed this truth to me. And you changed my heart. And you made me a new man. And Lord, I know that you possess the power today, this very moment, to do that with any person who has come to the end of themselves, who has come to the end of those gnawing doubts and questions. I don't know if I belong to Jesus. I don't know. Lord, you do not want us in that place. You came to die for us and rose again from the dead and poured out your Spirit on human flesh so that we could know beyond any shadow of doubt, beyond any question, that we are yours and that we have a home in heaven and that you are preparing a place for us even now. But Lord, I need to give you my life. I need to surrender it all to you, holding nothing back, clinging to nothing of myself, no efforts of my own, not my baptism, not my church membership, not my goodness, not my charitable giving, not my praying, not my anything. You alone, Lord Jesus, are my hope and salvation. And I give you my life today. I know what Pastor Paul is asking of me at this moment. I understand. And I say, take me, Lord Jesus. I am yours. Now and forever, I am yours. Take my life, Lord Jesus. I surrender my life to you, Lord Jesus. Have mercy on me, Lord Jesus. Forgive me of my sin. I repent. I repent, Lord Jesus. Come into my heart and make me a new creation. Pour your Holy Spirit into me and make me the child of God you want me to be. Hear my prayer. I ask it in your name. Amen.